ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ ಟುಡೇ 4th ಫೆಬ್ರವರಿ ವಿ ಆರ್ ಅಬ್ಸರ್ವಿಂಗ್ ವರ್ಲ್ಡ್ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ಸರ್ ಡೇ ಯು ಮೈಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಕಮ್ ಅಕ್ರಾಸ್ ಆರ್ ರೆಡ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ಸರ್ ಬಟ್ ದ ಇಂಟೆನ್ಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಬ್ಸರ್ವಿಂಗ್ ದಿಸ್ ವರ್ಲ್ಡ್ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ಸರ್ ಡೇ ಈಸ್ ಟು ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸ್ ದ ಅವೇರ್ನೆಸ್ ಟೇಕ್ ಔಟ್ ದ ಮಿಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಮಿಸ್ಇನ್ಫಾರ್ಮೇಷನ್ reduce the skill gaps as well as to easy access to the healthcare. In the world, nearly 14 million, that means 1.4 crore people are diagnosed with cancer every year. 1 in 6 deaths are due to cancer. In a recent survey, nearly 2/3 of people either suffered or come across with someone who is very close to them with cancer. So it is our duty to know more about cancer, how we all getting together, uniting, we can beat this cancer. That is the reason we are here and observing World Cancer Day. Today, the cancer team of Kasturba Medical College, KMC Hospital, Ambedkar Circle, Mangalore are here to briefly talk about the different types of cancers, how we detect them, how can we prevent them, and what are the principles of treatment. Today with us, myself, I am Dr. Harsha Prasada, pediatric hematologist and oncologist. On my left, I have Dr. Prashant, consultant hematologist and hemato-oncologist. Dr. Sanyo D'Souza, medical oncologist. Dr. Karthik, oncosurgeon. Dr. Harish, oncosurgeon, are with us. So to start, let me ask, in children we see very rarely some children with cancer. Having said that, whereas in adults it's much more common. I just want to know, I will ask Dr. Sanyo, what are the types of the cancers you come across in adults?
Yeah. So commonly we see in our daily practice, the common cancers probably we can divide among most common cancers in males versus most common cancers in females. So among the males, one of the common cancers is lung cancer and the oral cavity cancer. So these two are the most common cancers what we encounter in our place, and for that matter in India. And then among ladies, we see one of the commonest cancer is breast cancer, and then there are genital cancers like cervical cancer, and also this oral cancers and lung cancers are also one of the part, but commonly among ladies breast and gynecological cancers are the common. So that's how it is.
Where do you place hematological cancers in a general population, and how do they present?
The hematological cancers are the blood cancers, we say. It's a group of cancers. You know, when we tell about blood cancer, there are more than 100-150 subtypes of blood cancers that are described nowadays. They are fairly common. Depending on the type of the blood cancer that we talk about, the incidence varies. Like, you know, we are talking about a cancer like multiple myeloma, which is extremely common in our country, especially in the rural areas. It's become very common. Whereas if we talk about some type of lymphomas, they are extremely rare. Sometimes there is something called hairy cell leukemia. In our entire practice of 10 years, 15 years, we may come across one or two patients for that. So it is difficult to exactly put a number that, okay, this many percentage of patients generally develop blood cancer. But rather than that, what I feel is that most important thing a person should do is get an early checkup. Now, the in my practice, what I see is there are two sets of people who generally come to us. One are the set of people who are overzealous of diagnosing and cancer. Doctor, I want to see whether there is a cancer in me, so please do some tests. Now, whether it is blood cancer or any other type of cancer, a simple blood test immediately cannot detect, especially in a healthy person who is otherwise completely normal. Then there is another set of people where they are really suffering from cancer. They have symptoms, they have swellings in their particular parts of the body, or they are having some gum bleeding, swelling of the gums, swelling in the neck, they are having recurrent fever, but then they are not ready to get examined because they don't want to get tested, because doctor may tell that I have a cancer, then what I will do? No, this is unique to our country. That's what I feel, that you know, the two extremes are very common here. So most important, you know, as our talk progresses, we will tell the symptoms of the cancer. Somebody who has a symptom, one thing I want to stress upfront, there is no specific symptom or sign for any cancer as such. Just because somebody has a cough, it doesn't become lung cancer. Somebody has bleeding gums, doesn't become a blood cancer. There is nothing that tells that upfront, the moment we see a patient, okay, this is cancer. So people should not feel that, okay, I have this symptom, okay, I have a cancer. But it may be anything, but if you have a symptom, always get it checked with a specialist, then you will come to know. So I think with that, we will proceed with the symptoms of the cancer.
Thank you, Dr. Prashant. So bleeding gums, any swellings in a part of the body, not a particular symptom, don't get disheartened or worried immediately, but go and get checked by the specialist doctor and then take it from there. So that's about the some of the hematological cancers per se. Can I ask, Harish is being oncosurgeon, many of those where you do therapy treatment as a surgery, what are the types of cancers where you see as a first port of call, in the sense they present to you, with what symptoms they present to you? Would you please enumerate that?
Sir, the common signs and symptoms they present, a cancer patient is, if you ask me, if a sore which is not healing, like a wound anywhere in the body which is not healing, so ulcer in oral cavity or ulcer over the skin, which is since long time patient is having that, even after taking treatment it is not reducing, or bleeding anywhere in the body. Just say if a patient comes with hemoptysis, like a sputum, cough, sputum is there, along with that there is some blood, so that is a worrisome symptom, so which is there since long time. And bleeding per rectum, so many of the patients, I am not saying, as Dr. Prashant told, all bleeding per rectums are not cancerous, but we do see in our practice that many of the patients are treated as piles or something else, hemorrhoids, and they are missed the cancerous thing in that. So what happens, it is better to check anywhere bleeding first, to consult the relevant doctor and rule out cancer. Cancer is a small part compared to the non-cancerous things, but it is always good to diagnose cancer in early stage. So other than that, bleeding per urethra, so that is also, that is while passing urine, if the patient is passing blood, or unexplained loss of weight. So somebody who has lost more than 10 kgs in last 6 months without doing anything, like he is not doing regular exercise, not on diet, something, but still he has lost weight, which is not explained by anything. So they should be worried. And something like a patient who has altered bowel habits, somebody who is having diarrhea, and somebody who is having constipation for a long time, which is not matched to his regular habits. So these altered bowel habits should be aware. So these are some of the, and lump in the body, like any swelling in the neck or any swelling in the breast. So if you ask me, as Dr. Sanyo told, in female, the common cancers are breast cancers, and common cancers are gynecological cancers. So a patient who is breast cancer patient, who can present with lump in the breast, So if it is a gynecological patient, they present with bleeding per vagina, which is maybe postman, especially all these cancers what we see in elderly population are or in adults are in elderly population, like more than 40 years or 50 year later. So that is the common cancer. I think you know pediatric cancers are little different from adult cancers. So these patients, especially if the patient present with lump in the breast, if the patient presents in the early stage, you are asking about surgical aspect. So if the patient comes in the early stage, we first try to diagnose the cancer. So there are few tests which we have to do on this patient, like a mammogram for a breast cancer and a biopsy. If at all it's in early stage, like we call it stage 1 or stage 2 as early cancers. If it is in the later stage, we will not do surgery immediately. If it is in early stage, we diagnose the cancer and then we will take the patient for surgery. So there are so many patients like this who present in early stage whom we directly do surgery, and there are patients who present in little later stage, we may have to give chemotherapy first, that is called neoadjuvant chemotherapy, and then do surgery. So that is how this patient present to us.
Dr. Harish has enumerated few symptoms which are very pathognomonic of the features of cancers, and he mentioned one thing: cancer is one diagnosis, whereas there are many differential diagnoses for the symptoms. So, and he as well as Karthik routinely come across patients who have been neglecting these symptoms for a long time, and he said when you present early, then the treatment will be different, and they could do, especially if there are lumps or bleeding only a small part of the body, then they are able to take it out by doing surgery. Going to Dr. Karthik with the similar to the presentation, the common surgical oncosurgical problems or diagnosis you come across in day-to-day practice, and how do they present, which not been enumerated by the Harish?
Yeah, most of the things have been covered by our doctors. Now, like one of the most common attitude of people about cancer is they think that cancer is painful. So they don't want to come to the doctor unless there is pain. So unlike the popular thought where people think that cancer is painful, it is not so in the early disease. Let us take it, whether oral malignancy of stage 1 or 2 or breast cancer of stage 1 or 2. Even I can say you most of the cancers, even liquid cancer like leukemia or lymphoma, they are not painful. So people have this attitude of staying away from the doctor, and that is a kind of attitude they have because they don't want to come to hospital. So that attitude should go off. So what they should understand is we have to diagnose more and more patients in stage 1 and 2. Abroad, like in European countries or American countries, like all we know, they are more focused on stage on finding patients in stage 1 and 2, and so their prognosis is better, the treatment cost is better, the treatment duration is better, and overall it's a happy attitude towards the disease. But here what is happening in India is people have a very negative attitude about cancer, and we find more and more patients presenting to us in stage 3 and stage 4. That is not good. We have to find our ways to find more and more patients in early disease early stages, and we have to be able to treat the disease. And one more important aspect or point what I want to put here is like about the nihilistic attitude of the people. So they have a very negative attitude about cancer. So they have that bad picture of cancer that it is very painful, patients have to lose weight to have cancer, and so many dark thoughts about cancer that should we should be, as a society we should alleviate those factors, and we should encourage more and more people to come to us, and so that we can treat the people better in stage 1 and 2.
Thank you Dr. Karthik. So once they present to you us with the symptoms, what all the tests you would do to diagnose these to have cancer. So would you please enumerate, Dr. Sanyo?
Yeah. So the tests which we conduct, once we have a suspicion of a cancer in a particular patient, for whatever complaints they have come to us, differs based on which site or organ is affected. Like for example, if I start from above to below, for example, if someone comes with a non-healing ulcer in mouth and there is a swelling or something like that, or there is a swelling in the in our neck due to an ulcer inside the mouth, then commonly what we do is we do a biopsy of biopsy or FNA, that is fine needle aspiration we call it. So we either do a FNA or biopsy of that involved lesion or the abnormal area, and then we do a CT scan or a MRI scan to see has the disease spread beyond certain limits. So that's how we stage the that particular cancer. For example, if I go below still regarding the cancer of the lung, so even there, once we do a biopsy which is confirmatory of a particular cancer, like I would like to say at this point that if someone comes with some X-ray finding of some abnormality in the lung, that doesn't mean it is a cancer, it may be many other things also. So to confirm that it is a cancer, we need to do something called as needle test, just now, like what I said, either biopsy or FNAC to confirm that it is a cancer. So once we confirm that it is a cancer, for example in the lung, and then we have to do something called as CT scan or full body scan is done, called as PET scan sometimes in some cancers. So these scans are done to know whether the disease has spread to some other parts of the body or whether disease has spread away from the main site of origin of the tumor, so that we do the staging, I mean stage 1, 2, 3 or 4 of that particular disease. In the same way, for example, in our digestive system cancers, like for example in the stomach or in the intestine cancers, in those sites also, if at all patient presents with some symptoms suggestive of cancer in either stomach or in the intestine, then we do something called as endoscopy, either passing a small tube through the mouth or passing a small tube through the anal side to see where is the location of the cancer. And then once again, like what I said just now, to see whether the disease has spread to other parts, we need to do a CT scan or a whole body PET scan to see whether the disease has spread to other parts of the body. So basically speaking, that cancer, once we have a suspicion that someone is having a cancer, we need to do two important things. That one is the biopsy, and one is the one biopsy for the confirmation that it is a cancerous, and scans, whatever scans be as per the particular different sites, to see whether it has spread to some distant parts of the body or away from the site of origin of the tumor. So that's how it is.
Thank you, Dr. Sanyo. Once we diagnose or suspect a cancer, patients may feel that we are doing a battery of tests, but it's always important to have a right diagnosis and right staging, because the treatment may differ. So confirmation of the diagnosis and proper staging is must after diagnosing a cancer. So once you break the news of a cancer to patients, they will start to question us, why did I get cancer? Did I do anything wrong? Should I have done anything differently? So Dr. Prashant, would you like to talk upon that?
Yeah, this is a very interesting question. You know, every person who gets a disease, he has a right to ask this question. First, number one, you know, everybody has a right to ask question, and especially when, you know, a person is being diagnosed with a dreaded disease like cancer, definitely he needs an answer why he developed it, because if there is something that he can rectify, you know, to prevent future cancers either in him or in his family members, near and dear ones, then that becomes extremely crucial. So if we see why the cancer comes, there are answers for at least 50% to 70% of the cancers. We have an answer, especially the modern lifestyle, especially bad habits like smoking,
usage of drugs, illicit drugs, then alcohol, you know, excessive intake of alcohol, excessive intake of carbohydrates, fatty foods, you know, junk foods, and especially the fast foods, you know, the smoked foods. You get these kebabs and this other junk food where there is a soot on the surface of the foodstuff. Now, all these are, you know, containing highly carcinogenic, you know, chemicals in them, and when we consume them, you know, just because I have gone and eaten one fish kebab, I am not going to get any cancer there. But then cancer is always a multifactorial one. I am not doing regular exercises, I am not doing any, you know, weight management, I am putting on weight, I am not following any healthy diet per se, I am going on, you know, eating whatever comes in my way. You know, I have smoking habit of smoking, or that, you know, I may not be smoking, but you know, my friend who is always sitting next to me may be smoking, and I am happily smoking whatever he is leaving. You know, that is also is enough. So the lifestyle, everything matters. Over a period of time, these carcinogens give and they go on attacking the body cells, and body has a threshold limit to which body can repair itself. When the insults go beyond that threshold level, body fails, the immune system or the surveillance system in the body fails, and the normal cells which were otherwise behaving normally turn into cancerous cells, and then, you know, the entire process of cancer starts. Yes, of course, in around 20 to 30% of the cancers, especially a lot of these childhood cancers, there is no exact reason. It may be some underlying genetic problem which is not in the hands of either parents or in anybody's hands, you know, it's just by luck, we can say. Or some of the blood cancers, why do they get blood cancer, nobody knows, except for few of the cancers where pesticides are blamed for or smoking is blamed for. Otherwise, we don't have a true answer for this. So in a way, it is difficult to tell exactly particular patient, okay, you got this cancer because of this particular reason. But then we can broadly, you know, guess, you know, what was the lifestyle of the patient which caused this cancer.
Thank you, Dr. Yeah. Prashant. Dr. Prashant just gave the details of why one would get a cancer, especially in adult population. Being a pediatric oncologist, I do come across same question from every parents. They themselves feel guilty. Did we do anything wrong for my son or child to develop this cancer? Most of the times we do not have an answer. As he said, nearly 1/4 of childhood cancers are known genetic problem. But the question comes, can we prevent this cancer in children? Unfortunately, no. There are various hypotheses why someone develops a cancer in a child, but there are no hypotheses how can we prevent it. There are quite significant differences between children and adult type of cancers. As he mentioned, the lifestyle related cancers we do not see in children. Children is mainly due to do the genetics, the known genetics only 1/4 of them. We diagnose cancer in children usually in advanced stage. They would have spread by the time we diagnose. Whereas in adults, if they come early, they would diagnose in earlier stage. In children, the response to treatment is very good. Very intense treatment, short treatment, response is very good. And overall survival is very good. Whereas in adults, depending upon the types of cancers, etc., but overall the response is less than the childhood cancers. So with that note, continuing from the lifestyle related issues, now we'll go to the basic principles of treatment aspect, and then we will discuss about the early detection, screening and prevention aspect. So let me ask you, Dr. Sanyu, What are the principles of treatment in a diagnosed and confirmed cancer?
Yeah. So once we diagnose the cancer and once we do the staging, like what we discussed through the whatever relevant scans. So once we diagnose the cancer to be at a particular stage, then comes the treatment. So I will just give us overview of how the treatment is done in different cancers in general. So there are three main treatments of cancer. So one is surgery, one is radiation therapy, and one is chemotherapy. So any cancers, at least one is definitely required, at least one we call it modalities of treatment, surgery, radiation, and chemotherapy. So for any cancer, at least one modality of the treatment is definitely required. Most of the cancers, either two or three modalities are required. Like for example, some cancers which originate from the blood, like lymphomas, blood cancers, for that only chemotherapy is enough. But most other tumors, like common cancers like breast, where all the three modalities may be required, like surgery, chemotherapy, and radiation therapy. But this is, I'm saying, is not in all the patients all treatments are required. Even in, for example, in breast cancer, some patients we may need only surgery and chemotherapy, some patients we may need only surgery. So so different cancers are managed in different ways by different combinations of surgery, chemotherapy, and radiation therapy. But from last decade, there has been something new modalities of treatment also with regard to systemic therapy, we can say, that is called targeted therapy and immunotherapy. So this mostly is done for late stages of cancer, especially stage 4. What happens is that the mutation in the cells is detected in few patients, and we give treatment targeting to that particular mutation or change in the cell. So that we call as targeted therapy. So this is one new therapy, which is a tablet treatment. Which is a new treatment which has come up in the last decade. I would not say in all the cancers, but in many cancers it has come up. And one more new treatment which has come up in the last decade is immunotherapy, which is it is an intravenous injection, which is to be given over periodic intervals. And this too is usually in the late stages or the stage 4 cancers, we say. What it does is it stimulates the immune system of your own body to act on the cancerous cells. So that's how it acts and has been found to be beneficial in many tumor types. So that's how we treat cancer, and that's how we try to improve the survival of patients with cancer. But one important thing during all these treatments is our aim is to give the patient a good quality of life during whatever treatments we choose, because apart from increasing the life, meaning to say apart from increasing the survival of the patient, our one more aim is to improve the quality of life of the patient too, because commonly there is a notion in general public that cancer treatments are painful and patient his health condition will deteriorate, his general condition will go down, he will not be able to do day-to-day routines and all that. I would like to differ and say that when cancer treatment is given in a proper way, all these things do not occur. Of course, sometimes some side effects of chemotherapy can occur, but these are all for short duration. Immediately after surgery there may be some weakness, but this is of short duration. But overall, the aim of us doctors is to give a good quality of life to the patient with whichever cancer treatments we plan for a particular patient.
Thank you. If you give right treatment in right way, you may get side effects for a short duration, for which you have got medicines for those side effects. And as a doctor, as a team led by the medical oncologist and surgical oncologist all putting together, we all try to give a good quality of life to the patients. Dr. Harish, would you please tell me how can we screen or detect early detection of cancer in general public?
Early detection is something where we detect cancer in a patient who is having symptom. See, somebody who is having already some ulcer or lump in the breast, or somebody who is having bleeding per rectum or something. So where he can present in different stages, stage 1, 2, 3, 4. If we can detect in the early stage, like stage 1, so we can treat better. So that is how we can detect the patients in early stage, depending on when whether the patient is having symptom or not. So that is called early detection. That is done when the patient visits the hospital early, or we can also do general populations programs. So that time we can detect the lesion and do a biopsy or imaging, what we have already mentioned. That is called early detection. There is another thing called screening. Screening is something we do in general population, like we are doing programs and in a population where they don't have any symptom, they don't know there is something in their body, but we are trying to detect it. It may be cancer. So that is how, that is what is called screening. So we can't screen all the cancers. So there are so many cancers, but that is because whatever we screen, we have to detect early and we have to treat. Otherwise, there is no point detecting something and without giving proper treatment for that. So only some cancers are there, like breast cancer, where we can do a mammogram for screening. So oral cavity cancers, where we do screening, there may be lesions like white lesions or reddish lesions, like called leukoplakia or erythroplakia, or there may be an ulcer during our screening programs. So we can take biopsy of those lesions, which are maybe precancerous or in the early stage of cancer. And lung cancer, that low dose CT scan, that's what we say. And it is not practiced in many countries. Few countries and few areas it's been practiced where the detection rate is also high. We use low dose CT scan, not an X-ray there. Other than that, cervical cancer, which is a very important cancer, most of the cervical cancer is because of HPV infection. So human papilloma virus is more than 90% of the cause for this cervical cancer. So in this situation, we can do a simple test called pap smear, so which can detect the cancer in the general population, and with that we can actually treat the cancer better. So all these cancers where a proper test is available to detect a cancer, we can detect the cancers in general population and treat them better. So because of this, we know that compared to the previous decade, the cervical cancer incidence has come down with proper hygiene and also screening programs, which many of the centers in India are also doing. So that's how we can detect and about screening, sir.
Thank you. Dr. Karthik, would you please tell us what are the risk reduction things one has to do if he's well, but he's worried about he may get cancer in the future, what he can do to prevent the cancer? And second question is, what is the role of vaccines?
Yeah, this is a very important question, because this is also one of the gist of the World Cancer Day. So to understand about how to prevent, so prevention is even before the pathology has started. Dr. Prashant already told that the factor causing cancer is environmental and host factor. So environmental factor is like pollution, dust, or whatever the hazards of the present day life, which requires the whole society to act and control, which is little difficult because you need governance to control at that level. To our level, what we can do, so that is on the host factor. So host factor, what is responsible from the host to cause cancer? So one is these addictions, tobacco or alcohol among the most common addictions. Then the whatever reduces the immunity of a body to fight the early cancer cells. So this has to be improved to control cancer. So about let me speak briefly about tobacco and alcohol. So alcohol potentiates tobacco most commonly, and that's how alcohol acts. That is why we always tell to prevent alcohol, but we always tell to stop smoking. So that word we have to understand. And after the decades of negligence or decades of denial towards tobacco, then in the early 90s, America started with the Tobacco Prevention Act. From there, actually it took 3 decades, and now America, US has reduced the tobacco causing malignancies by 50%. So we are in the early phases of this, and we have to take it as a individualistic attitude to stop smoking, prevent smoking. So that is one aspect. And then about that aspect of the addictions, then about improving the host immunity, regular exercises to reduce, to maintain a healthy BMI, and to improve the quality of food items, take more and more food which has more of antioxidants, and avoid carcinogenic food like charred meat products or salted meat products. So the basics of what, then the most important aspect is the like the second question what you mentioned is about vaccine preventable disease. In malignancy also we have some vaccine preventable. Most importantly, what we already know and what is very popular is hepatitis B vaccine. So hepatitis B is responsible for chronic cirrhosis, which in turn causes malignancy of the liver in 2 or 3 decades of span. So hepatitis B vaccine prevents malignancy of the liver, and we should actively participate in the hepatitis B vaccination. And now what we speak recently is like human papilloma virus. We have already discussed human papilloma virus causing carcinoma cervix, and also nowadays oral malignancies caused by human papilloma virus. So popularly we have two kinds of vaccine. That quadrivalent or bivalent, that is Gardasil or Cervarix, which is the brand, which costs around 3000 rupees per shot. And when it has to be taken, it has to be taken in early teens, in 11 to 13 years of age, and 2 shots has to be taken. So that's a good preventive modality of in vaccine prevention. So when it comes to cancer, we have 2 broad vaccine preventable disease, that is liver malignancy of the liver, and malignancy caused by human papilloma virus. So this is about prevention. So we have to be aware. We have to be aware, and we should come out of the denial mode and get into a positive mode and treat the cancer effectively.
Thank you, Dr. Karthik. World Cancer Day is unique in the sense, though it's been observed for the past 20 years since the year 2000, we have in the middle of pandemic. You all know this pandemic made almost all citizens aware of their health and about the cleanliness, infection control practices, and everyone is worried about COVID, especially so those who are receiving treatment for cancer or their relatives. So I just want to ask Dr. Prashant, how COVID has affected the cancer care, and what are the problems extra they will face because of their COVID?
So it's very important nowadays, because whatever we are seeing, COVID doesn't seem to be like, you know, disappearing very soon. It is going to be with us for quite some time. Since last 1 year, now we have a large body of data of what happens for a cancer patient when he develops COVID infection. Now we clearly know, just like any other infection, you know, for a cancer patient has a defective immunity. That is why on the first place he has developed a cancer. So with that defective immunity, any infection will increase the chance of increased morbidity, that is more sickness, and also the chance of dying because of the infection. Just same way, COVID also, the data is around cancer patients are, the risk is almost 2 to 2.5 times more in cancer patients the COVID death rate rather than a normal population. Now, the other important aspect is, you know, because of this COVID pandemic, we were forced to modify all our chemotherapy, surgical protocols, you know, lot of the patients received dose reductions in the chemotherapy. Thereby, there may be certain, you know, compromise on the overall survival of the patient because of the cancer. But then, you know, if you had given the full dose, there was a chance that patient would have died because of COVID, there was an immediate death. So, to prevent the immediate death, there has been certain measures that are taken, which may be little troublesome for the long term. The next thing that we are now, in the future, we are looking at is, invariably, just like any other normal population, the patients who have been, you know, recovered of the COVID, just like patients who have otherwise, you know, required of malaria or typhoid or dengue fever, over a period of time, they can develop cancer. Not that COVID is causing cancer, invariably they would have, even without getting COVID, they would have developed the cancer. Now, the patient who had a COVID infection comes with the cancer. Now, what happens is that with the COVID, they would have had end organ damages to the lungs, to the liver or kidneys. Now, it is going to be a big challenge for us to, you know, formulate the right treatment for these patients, because we know that all our drugs, we have some amount of side effects. So, there is a chance that these end organ damages may trouble the patient. So, that is why it is extremely crucial for any point of view. Now, I am not talking just about cancer prevention per se, whether it is heart disease or lung disease or whatever disease that we talk of, it is extremely important to prevent COVID infection. So, whatever government is telling, we just have to sincerely follow, because they, government, the politicians are not telling it. It is the scientific body which is analyzing the situation and giving guidelines to the government. And government is a mouthpiece for this scientific body. So, we have to follow that. Well, other common question that is asked by a lot of our patients is that, you know, can we receive a COVID shot, you know, vaccine? No, patients who have been treated of cancer earlier or those who are having active cancer also, you know, if they get an opportunity to get COVID vaccine, they should get it. Because there is no risk in taking COVID vaccine, because it is a killed vaccine. It is not a live virus vaccine. So, there is no harm in the patient. Only thing is that effectiveness of the COVID vaccine may be slightly on the lower side in patients who are having active cancer or those who have been treated for cancer. But if given a chance, everybody should get a COVID vaccine. That's what I would talk about COVID.
Thank you, Dr. Prashant. Every year on the World Cancer Day, the Union of International Cancer Association, they come up with a theme. For the past 3 years, the theme is I am, I will. The very purpose of today's discussions, answering the questions, is to make all of us united in fighting against a cancer, remove all the myths and misinformation, easy to get access and make it affordable as well. Today, we touched upon the basics of common presentation of cancer, early diagnosis, detect the basics of principles, prevention, screening, and also on COVID and cancer. With that note, I would like to conclude today's discussion. Thanks Dr. Prashant, Dr. Sanyo D'Souza, Dr. Harish, Dr. Karthik. Thank you.